Spain. Hello. Can I help you?
Yeah, Mr. Barker?
Yeah, I'm Stan Barker, but do I know you?
Yeah, Mike Kasnoff.
Yeah, right.
A friend of mine was in here the other day shopping for a car, and you gave her this.
Does your friend have a name?
Yeah, Carly. Carly Tenney?
Oh, my gosh.
What?
There's an ad in here for that Cabot sports car I told you about. The one they call the dream car.
A convertible?
Yeah. Can you believe this car can go from 0 to 60 in 4.5 seconds?
It's a fast car.
Honey, that's lightning. Dream a little dream with Cabot. That's a great ad campaign. Gotta tell you, I've dreamed of driving one. Top down, wind in your hair.
If you ask me, the Mountaineer's a lot more practical. Although, you know, this article talks about how proud and excited my dad was about the new convertible's design.
Yeah?
Yeah. That makes me proud of him. And it reminds me, it's probably time I do what you said.
About what?
About that money that he left me.
I'm sure he wanted you to spend it any way you like.
Exactly. Which is why I gotta make sure a lot of it goes where it belongs.
To a good cause.
Dr. Brody, you've been practicing medicine for over 30 years, is that correct?
Yes.
And in light of the autopsy and having reviewed Mr. Grimaldi's emergency room chart, would you have handled Mr. Grimaldi's injuries any differently than Dr. Dixon?
No. I'd have done exactly what Dr. Dixon did.
Then you agree with Dr. Horton and Dr. Fahey and all of the other experts that I've questioned that Dr. Dixon did nothing wrong?
Yes.
Thank you. You're a witness.
I'll wait in cross-examination, Your Honor.
Dr. Brody, you may step down. Miss Griffin, call your next witness.
The defense calls Dr. Susan Stewart.
And it's time you were doing the same.
Oh, I'm not even tired. I'd like to stay out here a little longer. I'd actually like to take some pictures of the gardens.
All right. I'll walk with you then, shall I?
Okay.
The world turns.
Joanna, wait.
What is it? What's wrong?
Look at the light. It's so beautiful right here. It's perfect. I want to take a picture of you.
Oh, no, you don't.
I do. I really do. Oh, not a film. I have no film.
Well, do you have some more film in your room?
I do have another roll.
Well,
I do.
You just stay put. I'll fetch it for you.
Okay, it's in the drawer next to the bed. Or maybe it's not. I don't know. Just keep looking until you find it, okay?
Thanks.
Mark, I thought you weren't coming.
Look, sit down, but don't look in my direction. It was probably a stupid move on my part. You're locked in, I'm locked out. The town's mobbed because of the festival, and my ship's not going anywhere until it's over.
You don't think I'm crazy?
How long do you think your nurse will be gone?
Well, there's no film. Send her on a wild goose chase. We have a few minutes, definitely.
No, Look, I gotta be honest with you. I don't see how I'm gonna get you out of this place.
I'll handle that. You have to rescue my son.
Wait a minute. I didn't sign on for any kidnapping of babies. I'm just here because something doesn't seem right.
Something is not right. Nothing is right. My son is in danger. Please. My mother-in-law is obsessed with him. She's putting something in my food. She's drugging me to make me have these hallucinations. That's why I ended up here in the first place. And I think my husband's in on it, too. He even admitted drugging me to get me here from the States.
Oh, come on. Stuff like that doesn't happen.
It's happening. It's happening right now. I saw Scott Eldridge, didn't I? They're trying to make me believe that I'm crazy, and you know that they're lying. Please, they'll do anything to keep me away from my son. Please, I can't trust any of them.
You must have trusted your husband once. I mean, you married the guy.
I did. But now, so many things have happened, nothing makes any sense to me. Please, you have to rescue my son before it's too late. Please.
Where is he now?
He's in the villa, up on the cliff.
The one you can see from town? That place looks like a fortress.
It is.
Okay, no promises, but, I'll scope the villa out.
Thank you. I'll find a way to repay you, I promise.
Give me your camera.
Why?
Because.
What? Just be careful, please.
Be back. I'll knock on your window when I get here.
No, don't do that, because my mother might be there, and that... Joanna's coming back.
I'll play it for you when I get back.
Okay.
I couldn't find that film anywhere.
Oh, I must have made a mistake. I'll have my mother buy some tomorrow.
Oh, well. The light's changed anyway, and... What have you done with your camera? What a cheerful boy. Today there's going to be a big celebration. I'm going to present my grandson to the whole world. Everyone will love you. No one will love you as much as I do. Hey, here's your papa.
Here's my boy. Come here, Luciano. Hey, what are you looking up? Hey, tell me, you miss mommy? Don't worry. I'm going to see her very soon.
Senora, see mommy very soon. The musicians have arrived. I told them to set up in the garden.
Good. Keep an eye on them, will you?
The musician, mom, what's going on?
Well, have you forgotten? It's a festa. The Grimaldis have always had open house in the entire town.
Wait a second, mommy. You organize a public celebration here at the villa while my wife is at the clinic? You'll have to cancel it.
We're heads of the community. Grimaldis have always taken part in the festa. We have to.
Well, if you insist, suit yourself.
Then Luciano and I will go see Mama and spend the night at the clinic.
No.
What do you say?
No. You've forgotten our traditions. The infants are always presented in a ceremony at the chapel, and tomorrow will be Luciano's public christening.
So it was very busy in the emergency room that night.
It was unbelievable. All those accidents because of the fog. A lot of staff had been called in to help out.
Then Dr. Dixon wasn't the only doctor working overtime.
No, there were lots of us there, all exhausted and running on adrenaline.
Did that worry you?
Made me remember my Hippocratic Oath.
Which is?
When you become a physician, you take an oath to care for the sick. Not just when you're healthy and rested, but when they need you. And the patients in the ER needed John Dixon that night. He's one of the best.
Objection, witness is volunteering an opinion.
Sustained.
Is it true that in spite of the emergency situation, Dr. Dixon was asked to leave? Could you answer the question yes or no for the record?
Yes. The chief of staff made a judgment call.
And did you agree with that call?
Objection, Your Honor.
Sustained.
Dr. Stewart, if you were ordered to stop treating patients and leave an overcrowded emergency room, not because of symptoms of an illness or a fever, but because you simply looked tired, would you obey that order?
No. Most doctors wouldn't in a situation like that.
So you're saying that most doctors would defy their chief of staff?
Anything can happen if people feel that the chief of staff is too wrapped up in his own authority.
Thank you. No further questions.
Mr. Hamlin?
I have no questions for Dr. Dixon's good friend, Your Honor.
Careful, Mr. Hamlin. You may step down, Doctor. Miss Griffin, call your next witness.
We call Kimberly Hughes.
If I look under the hood, Stan?
Well, no, that's a precision machine there. It's not really meant for just casual...
Oh, man! Now that is an engine!
Inspection, actually.
Woo! But you could really torque her up, huh?
Oh, yeah.
Come on, so what does she do? 0 to 60 in 5?
4.5, actually.
Wow, that's almost as fast as my Ludi Bell.
Excuse me?
My race car.
Yeah. You said your friend, what's her name, Carly?
Yeah, Carly Tenney.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I don't remember anybody by that name, so...
Really? She's got one of those faces that just most people don't forget.
Well, what does she look like?
Oh, well, she's got blonde hair, looks a little bit like, Michelle Pfeiffer, you know, got those sexy lips.
Oh, yeah. I remember her now.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. So you said that you're a racer.
Yeah, just won a Sundown Classic.
You're the guy who just wants to see
you're looking at him.
Whoa! Yep. You know, because your name did sound familiar.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
So what, did Miss Tenney, she sent you down here to check out the car before she buys it?
Well, you know, I got to tell you, Stan, this kind of car like this is right up her alley.
All right.
So, how many ponies she got under there?
It's 328, actually.
Ouch.
Yeah.
Ouch.
You know, I knew that she'd come back. I mean, I've been in the business 10 years, and, I mean, I can smell a prospect a mile away.
Yeah, I understand. I hear you. Yeah, she's pretty careful about saving her money, though.
She seemed like a really smart lady, though, you know? You know, I actually almost believed her when she said that she'd be running Cabot Motors someday, you know?
Yeah, Carly, she's got some big plans.
Yeah.
Just what sort of cause did you have in mind?
Well, I've been thinking about the AIDS unit at Memorial. Yeah, I think what I'm going to do is take some of the cash that's not tied up in the company and donate it to the hospital.
Rosanna, we're talking about millions of dollars here.
Yeah, millions of dollars that could help people with AIDS and maybe even contribute to help finding a cure. See, this means something. I know that this is the right thing to do. And I think my father would agree, too. I can almost hear him. What? Carly, you're the one who told me that I had a mission with this money.
Oh, I know. But not a mission to just throw it all away.
I don't think donating it to the AIDS unit is throwing it away.
I didn't mean it that way. I meant... But if your dad wanted to give it to charity, he would have done it himself.
Well, so, what should I do? Should I just take a trip around the world and just forget about the people who live in it? Carly, I don't understand. What do you want from me?
I want you to give yourself time. I've said all along you shouldn't make any major moves until you're back on solid ground again. And right now, you're anything but.
Because I haven't been being responsible about this inheritance, and it's driving me crazy, Carly, and you're not helping.
Don't blame this on the money, Rosebud. That's not what's making you crazy.
Really?
Yeah, really. You and I both know that the problem is Mike.
I don't understand what he has to do with any of this.
He has everything to do with this. You're so mixed up about him, you can't think straight about anything else.
Carly, please. You gotta try to get over this problem that you have with Mike.
I'm just calling it how I see it. You want the guy, but then again, no, you don't. I mean, it's this old push-pull thing. That's what's making you crazy. And it's killing me.
Mrs. Hughes, how long have you known the defendant, John Dixon?
Almost 24 years.
And would you say you know him well?
Very well. We were married at one time. He's the father of my oldest son.
And what is your son's name?
Andrew Dixon.
Objection. All of this is irrelevant.
Your Honor, if you just bear with me, I think this is very relevant.
Proceed.
There was an incident in London that involved your son Andrew, which had to do with a bombing.
Yes.
Would you tell us exactly what happened?
A terrorist set off a car bomb.
A terrorist?
Yes. My son was badly wounded. He nearly died.
Can you tell us the name of the terrorist?
Hans Mueller.
The same Hans Mueller who shot Eduardo Grimaldi?
Yes.
The same Hans Mueller whose life Dr. Dixon tried to save on the operating table that night?
Yes.
Even though this same man almost killed your son in that bombing incident, Dr. John Dixon treated him and tried to save his life.
Well, that's the kind of man that John is. When it comes to saving lives, he's...
Sustained. Mrs. Hughes, please just answer the question.
Yes, Your Honor.
So, no matter what Dr. Dixon feels about his patients, it would not, in your opinion, affect how he treated them, whether it's Hans Mueller or Eduardo Grimaldi or anyone else?
Obviously not.
Thank you. Your witness.
I have no questions.
You may step down, Mrs. Hughes. Miss Griffin, call your next witness.
We call Thomas Hughes.
One of the other patients walked off with your camera.
That's what happened. I turned around, turned my back for a second, and it was gone.
But there wasn't any film in your camera.
Oh, I wasn't thinking, and he didn't know that.
Well, what did the other patient look like?
I don't remember. It's okay. It's not a big deal. Let's just forget about the camera, because I have to ask you something.
What?
A friend of mine is in town from the States, and I was wondering if he could come by and see me.
Miss Grimaldi, you know you're not allowed visitors.
No, just for a little while. I went to high school with him. Please?
All right. I'll ask Matron about it tomorrow.
Well, he wants to come see me tonight. Please don't look at me that way. I'm just very lonely. My husband's at the villa, working very hard. My mother has problems with her sister right now, and I really miss my son. Please let me see an old friend.
Mrs. Grimaldi, rules are rules, but I'll tell you what. If your friend comes by this evening, I'll telephone your husband. Oh, Miss Grimaldi, you all right?
No. Calling my husband would be the worst thing you could do.
No!
Forget about the festa, Mama.
When Luciano's christened, you'll have both his parents by his side.
Claro, the tradition.
Yeah, forget about the tradition, Mama. We're in a family situation here. Do you understand that? There will be no celebration until Lily's fine.
Claro, there is more at stake here than you realize.
What are you talking about?
Huh? You've been so worried about Lily. I didn't want to bother you with rumors, but the government is buzzing with talk that trouble in the family means there's trouble in the company as well. Even the locals are involved. If we show a united front at the festa, all this will stop. Believe me, Caro, if they don't share our joy, they'll think something's wrong. They'll say Luciano's mother is insane, and he'll have to live with it for the rest of his life.
Mama, people forget. You're the one who's always said that, right?
They will forget when they see their children christened alongside of Luciano. And we will smile and show the world that all is well.
No. We'd only show them that Luciano's mother isn't with us.
Doesn't matter. All eyes will be on the Grimaldis. And it's the festival of San Luca, his patron saint. We have to be there.
Signor Grimaldi, there'd be an intruder. A man broke into the brown of the estate.
What?
Si, signore.
My God, what's the big deal?
Mr. Grimaldi?
And now, part two of As the World Turns.
Mm-hmm.
You know my name. I'm sorry. Do I know you?
Yes, sir. You gave me a job. Remember?
I did?
Tunis. A couple of years ago, my ship ran aground, and the officials were giving me a hard time about my paperwork.
Oh, wait a second. You're the American, right? I cut through some red tape, and then I got your berth in one of our tankers.
Right. And I've been working for Kingsley Malta ships ever since. Tankers, steamers, yachts. It's been great.
So? What are you doing here?
I hiked up from the beach to get some shots of the view up here.
There are signs up there. And haven't you see it? It's private property here.
I saw a sign, and it was in Italian, and I guess I was trespassing. Sorry.
Daniel, who is this young man?
I'm surprised you have time for sightseeing. I mean,
watch my ship. It's stuck in port. One of the passengers went overboard the other night.
Oh. You're aboard the Mystic?
Yes, sir.
Ragazzi, please don't die.
I asked the captain to arrange an American crew for Kirk and Samantha. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry you had to get stuck here in port. Well, actually, you may not realize this, sir, but I'm still on your payroll.
Of course. I'm sorry. This is my mother, Olena Grimaldi.
Mark.
Please, feel free to enjoy the view.
Well, sorry for barging in, but it is beautiful up here.
It's best of time. The unexpected is always expected.
This is my son, Luciano. Luke.
Cute kid.
Yeah, sure is. He looked just like his mommy. Best thing of my whole life.
Harley, I am not confused about Mike. I'm just... Look, we're just taking things one step at a time, all right? Now, I've talked to Mike about this, and he doesn't have a problem with it. I don't understand why you do.
I don't give a damn about Mike. I'm talking about you. And you have to stop sitting on the fence here and start making
some... Well, all right, listen. What would you want me to do?
I'm not saying I want you to go to bed with Mike, but I do think you have to get rid of this frustration that's pent up inside of you.
How?
I can't make the decision for you. But if you still think that Mike is not trustworthy, then tell him to take a hike.
Talk about good surprises. Come on in.
You guys must be hot about something. I heard voices halfway down the hall. Is there a problem?
No, it's my fault. I was just a little concerned when Rosanna told me what she's planning to do with the money.
What?
All right, this has been in the back of my mind for a while now. I was thinking about taking the money that my father left me, some of it anyway, and donating it to the hospital for the AIDS unit there so I could help people, like
Heather.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I think that's a terrific idea.
Do you? Really?
Yeah. Does Carly have a better idea?
All I'm saying is think it through. It's my experience that when you act on impulse, you get into trouble.
Well, I think that Rosanna should do whatever she wants with her money.
Well, now we know what we all think.
Look, Harley, I know you mean well, but I really don't want us to fight about this. Whatever you say.
Why don't you and I go for a ride, Ralph? I've got something important I want to tell you.
I'm really sorry about all this, Rosanna. I didn't mean to rain on your parade. I just didn't want you to do something you'd regret. Go on with Mike. I'll see you later.
Okay.
You ready?
Yeah.
Mr. Hughes, were you acquainted with a woman by the name of Dawn Wheeler?
Yes. She was a friend of my family.
And did there come a time where she learned that she had a terminal illness?
Yes, she was diagnosed with AIDS.
And where did she live for the last few months of her life?
In Rockford.
Was she hospitalized there?
For a while, yes.
But she was able to spend her final days in home. Is that true?
Yes. That's the way she wanted it. The doctors at the Rockford Hospital fought her for a while on
objection,
it.
Irrelevant.
I have a point to make, Your Honor, if the court will just bear with me.
Overruled.
About Miss Wheeler, you were saying that the doctors were opposed to her leaving the hospital.
That is correct.
And what changed their minds?
John Dixon.
And how did he do that?
He convinced them that she had a right to die with dignity, in the privacy and the comfort of her own home, and with her son.
And did he ever go to see her after that?
Yes, he was uncomfortable leaving her in the care of a private nurse and therefore spent 8 to 10 hours a day with her, making sure that she received the kind of care that she needed up until the day that she died.
Mr. Grimaldi died. You saw Dr. Dixon at the hospital.
I did.
And was there anything in his demeanor that made you doubt he was capable of treating Mr. Grimaldi?
Objection calls for speculation.
Overruled.
Mr. Hughes?
I did not have any doubt.
Thank you. I know this must be very difficult for you.
He's going to need his bottle soon, Mama.
I'll get it. You stay with your guest.
No. I really should be going and let you people get back to whatever it was interrupted.
You didn't interrupt a thing. I'm just getting the house in order because we have open house tonight. And I hope you'll stay. Oh, please help yourself to some iced tea. The mint is grown in the garden.
There isn't going to be any party here tonight. Mom was just refusing to accept that.
Oh.
Yes, we had to cancel it. My wife is ill.
I'm sorry to hear that.
Yes, we all are.
I better get going. You don't need some stranger hanging around when your wife isn't feeling well.
She isn't here. She's in a private clinic. Actually, you being here helped. My mother stopped arguing with me. You do me a favor if you stick around for a while.
Hey, are you sure?
Positive. Borg, would you be so kind to pour some iced tea for our guest?
Si, signore. Would you like some too?
No, thanks.
I hope it isn't serious, your wife's illness.
She just had some trouble after our son was born. Please, sit down. Help yourself.
And you, my boy.
Yeah. I'm sure she'll snap out of it soon. But right now, her condition is kind of fragile. The only thing that really helped her is when I bring Luciano to see her. That always cheers her up. What am I doing? Standing here telling you all my problems, boring you with that.
It's all right. I really don't mind.
I guess it's true what they say. It's easier to talk to a stranger about your problems, someone who's not involved.
Funny how different things looked when I was down on the beach. Seemed like the people who lived up here had it made.
Yeah.
okay, sweetheart. Mommy loves you. Oh, you did it. You brought me my son. Oh, come here. Oh, gosh. Oh, Mommy missed you so much. We missed you so much. We'll never be apart again. I promise. He has to come back. He just has to. He's my only hope.
Mr. Hughes, did you have any personal knowledge of Mr. Grimaldi's medical history?
His medical history?
Yes, did he ever mention any chronic physical problems? Anything of that nature?
No, in fact, quite the opposite. He told me that he had always been in good health.
So why did the subject of his health come up?
He was going to marry my mother.
I'm not sure I understand.
I needed to ask him several questions as I needed his signature on a prenup that I had prepared.
A prenuptial agreement?
That's correct.
All right, let's get back to the night Mr. Grimaldi died. When you arrived at the hospital, was he conscious?
Yes.
And would you say that he was resting comfortably, or was he in a lot of pain?
I would say resting comfortably. He was in good spirits. He was talking and making jokes.
I see. And then what happened?
My mother began to get a migraine headache, and I talked her into going up to Dr. Gardella's office. He's her neurologist.
And how long did you stay there?
Quite a while. After she received her medication, I convinced her to lie down for a moment until the headache started to subside.
And would you say that you were there for half hour, an hour?
Closer to an hour.
And when you returned to the emergency room, Mr. Grimaldi had died.
That is correct.
What happened then?
My mother became very distraught.
And she blamed Dr. Dixon, or?
She blamed herself for not being there for Eduardo at that time. I believe that she still does.
Can I get you a drink? Anything?
Yeah, soda would be nice.
Okay. There you go. Or you.
Thanks.
Okay, well, we're alone now, and you can't keep talking about the view out the car window. Why don't you tell me what you and Carly were really arguing about when I got to the apartment?
Oh, you don't really want to know.
Of course I do. Unless you don't want to tell me.
No. No, I do. It's just... Carly thinks that I'm very confused right now because of you.
And
she feels pretty strongly that my life would be a lot easier without you in it.
You think that's any of her business?
Well, you know, she's my sister. She cares about me.
And do you agree with her?
No.
tell me the rest.
You know what? I really don't want to talk about this anymore. Would you mind just holding me for a little while?
It's Stan Barker, the salesman at the Cabot dealership. Now, is this Carly Tenney?
Yeah, this is Carly Tenney. But how did you...
I know. You didn't leave your name, and so I couldn't follow up on the convertible that you were interested in. But it's a good thing that your friend came by, and today he was checking out the car.
What friend?
Mike Kazanoff. Yeah, he seems like a real nice guy.
Just, you sure you don't want to talk about it?
Yeah, I'm sure. In fact, I don't really want to talk, period.
Thank you. No further questions.
Mr. Hamlin, your witness.
I have no questions for the district attorney, Your Honor.
Mr. Hughes, you may step down. Ms. Griffin, please call your next witness.
We'd like to recall Lisa Grimaldi.
Mrs. Grimaldi, I remind you that you are still under oath.
I'd like to have two bars set up, one in the library, one on the terrace.
Mm-hmm.
And would you be sure to see that the caterers do?
I hope you understand my decision, Mama.
You cannot stop the festa. It's impossible even for you.
Yes, but I can stop the Grimaldi's part in the festa. No party and no christening. Understood?
What happened to the nice young man from the yacht?
I hadn't driven back into town, Mama. I'll be in the nursery with Luciano if you need me, okay?
I want you to be sure that the caterers use the kitchen entrance. I don't
kitchen
want them
entrance?
Coming in from the front
yeah,
entrance.
There is, yeah.
It really is time for you to go in now, Mrs. Grimaldi.
Oh, can I just stay out a few more minutes?
Well, you might take a chill.
No, I want to have my shawl. I'm fine, really.
All right. But you must come in shortly. Your mother will be asking for you when she wakes up from a nap.
I will. I promise.
Please come back. Please come back.
See my son?
Why didn't you tell me your husband's Damian Grimaldi?
This fall, Nancy McKeon single.
Oh.
And ready to mingle.
Pearls or hoops?
Pearls say don't even try. Hoops say, if it's nice, do it twice.
I want a new best friend.
But with friends like this.
How's this? It's says leave a 50 on the dresser and toss me my beeper.
She'll never make it out the door.
But sexy, no?
You can't hurry love. Mondays this fall.
Hunt's new show is so uniquely Bonnie Hunt, we just had to call it The Bonnie Hunt Show, coming Fridays to CBS.
By Regina Porter. This is Dan Regan, inviting you to join us again Monday for As the World Turns.